her all these little packets?" asked Mr. Britling. Mrs. Faber looked slightly abashed. "Sarah Boss Salt," she said, "one gets carried away a little. I just got hold of it and carried it out to the car. I thought we might have to salt things later."
"And the jars are pickles," said Mr. Britling.
"Yes, but look at all my flour. That's what will go first."
The lady was a little flurried by Mr. Britling's too detailed examination of her haul.
"What good is blacking?" he asked.
She would not hear him. She felt he was trying to spoil her morning. She declared she must get on back to her home.
"Don't say I didn't warn you," she said. "I've got no end of things to do. There's peas. I want to show cook how to bottle our peas. For this year, it's lucky we've got no end of peas. I came by here just for the sake of telling you."
And with that, she presently departed, obviously ruffled by Mrs. Britling's lethargy and Mr. Britling's skepticism. Mr. Britling watched her go off with a slowly rising indignation.
"And that," he said, "is how England is going to war, scrambling for food at the very beginning."
"I suppose she is anxious for the children," said Mrs. Britling.
"Blacking."
"After all," said Mr. Britling, "if other people are doing that sort of thing."
"That's the idea of all panics. We've got not to do it. The country hasn't even declared war yet. Hello, here we are. Better late than never."
The head of the postman, bearing newspapers and letters, appeared gliding along the top of the hedge.